Paleoethnobotany is still developing an extremely absorbing and very useful scientific field, allowing to deepen archaeological knowledge. One of the areas of paleoethnobotany is the study of phytoliths and stud grains. Phytolith in ancient Greek means plant stone. They are strongly differentiated in terms of shapes and sizes. They consist of silicon dioxide, water 4 to 9%, and small amounts of aluminium, iron, magnesium, potassium, cuprum, nitrogen, and organic carbon 1 to 5%. During the life cycle, every plant absorbs water with monosilic acid from the soil. We have two reasons for the formation of phytoliths. First, this silica builds into the interior of cells, cell walls, or intercellular spaces in whole plant, leaves, stems, inflorescence. It is a process controlled by the plant genetically and physiologically. Second, depends on the climate and conditions in which the plant grows. Phytoliths perform a protective function by protecting plants from pests and microbes. Based on the observation of shapes and sizes, as well as comparative studies, we can determine the species affiliation of a particular phytolith. Phytoliths are extremely durable. They are resistant to soil acidity and temperatures up to more than 1000 degrees. Paleobotanical data from the Neolithic from southwestern Poland are very scarce. These are almost exclusively imprints of plants on the daub and at the bottoms of the vessels, as well as charred remains of plants, usually grains. This is due to the conditions of deposition in this part of Poland. These conditions make it impossible for organic matter, including plants and bones, to survive. Apart from these circumstances, few such analyses are performed. The map shows the number of sites where such remains have been examined. We can see there are few of them from the face of 3,000 years. Unfortunately, this distorts the knowledge about plant management. Most data concerns plants in contact with high temperature. At the same time, many plants, such as those belonging to the legume group, pea, lentil, etc., have no chance to be preserved in archaeological materials due to their structure. Unfortunately, we also have poor knowledge about the use of forest plants, wild strawberries, blueberries, nuts, as well as about spice plants and herbs. The species of a modern plant will genetically fully correspond to a species existing in prehistory in terms of structure. It is the same species. It is distinguished based on specific morphological features that are fully repeatable. However, we are not entirely sure how strongly the natural environment and the pesticides used today affect the evolution, shape, and amount of phytoliths. We must remember that even if we obtain plants from organic farming, it is very difficult to exclude pesticide retention in the soil or presence in groundwater. There is still no comparative database of phytoliths from Poland. In some cases, plants used in the Neolithic have undergone strong genetic transformations, and it is no longer possible to obtain a specific species. An example is barley and its varieties, Hordeum vulgare spontaneum and Hordeum vulgare vulgare. For these reasons, we propose to create a comparative database of contemporary plants, but also of plants from daub. The daub offers many research opportunities. An example is the analysis from Zarzyca, which allowed for a better understanding of plant management. The results, carried out by Dr. Agata Sade with smashed daub, allowed determining the type of plants and which parts of them are used as a tamper. Probably remnants of threshing were added. In the pictures, we can see the daub from Strzelin and a microscopic view of the remains preserved in it. They were extracted and photographed. Now they will be subjected to macroscopic analysis to later collect phytoliths from them. Collection of phytoliths from marked preserved remains gives us the opportunity to build a comparative database even when the species are not available today. The collection of phytoliths from the daub allows us to get additional information about plant management. It is also possible to collect phytoliths directly from the print, which is archaeobotanical defined. In every case, we can exclude any contamination. We are sure phytoliths comes from specific context and time. For the pilot study of phytoliths from daub, I used the daub from the site in southwest Poland, Strzelin 16, dated to Linear Pottery culture, 5600 to 4900, 4800 BC. I smashed the daub and scrubbed off the clay fragment from the print. After adding water, the sonication method has been applied. In the next step, the suspension was subjected to gravity sedimentation and centrifugation. After that, between successive centrifugation cycles, mineral contaminants were removed using hydrochloric acid, and organics were removed using, among others, nitric acid. Finally, microscope slides were prepared. Phytoliths of various shapes and sizes are visible microscopically. In the first, second, and third picture, we can observe, probably, grass silica short cell phytoliths. In the fourth picture, we can see long cell phytoliths, probably of epidermal projection like hers. Now it is difficult to assign them to specific species because we do not have a comparative database yet. It is certain, however, based on the study of grass phytoliths from the Falkland Islands, that the distinction of species is possible. Also, when it is impossible to distinguish species based on pollen. Work is underway on a comparative collection. Thank you for your attention.